Mom said, "Eat your vegetables. They're good for you." As kids, we chose the sweets, candy over carrots, every time. But as we age, we learn that what's good for us can be sweet too. The challenge is access, when processed is prevalent and sustenance is scarce. Making healthy choices becomes a luxury of the few. But some have decided it shouldn't have to be this way, planting mission and purpose into the soil of their dreams. Your mission and passion are one and the same, inspiring healthier communities by connecting people to real food. Growing from humble beginnings into a fresh, fast, farm-to-table phenomenon, you've revolutionized the salad business, all while staying connected to your roots. It all started out of your dorm room when you and your co-founders were just 22 years old. As college kids, what was the inspiration behind creating such a healthy concept like Sweetgreen?
We started Sweetgreen really to solve a problem in our own lives. I met both my co-founders while I was in college at Georgetown University. I met Nathaniel in Accounting 101. I sat behind him in class. He was wearing a Lakers hat. We bonded over both being from LA. And Nicholas, I met the first day I got to Georgetown, he was in the dorm next door to me. And so we bonded over this idea of creating a healthy place to eat that was delicious, affordable, convenient, and really stood for something. We also really all shared a passion for building something from scratch. And so we started writing a business plan with a simple mission that we still have today, which was building healthier communities by connecting people to real food. Food is really broken today in terms of, you know, the number of people that eat fast food daily. Almost 40% are obese, and also the terrible environmental effects of food on our environment. It's just such an opportunity to rethink the food system. People have asked us if we were scared or if it felt risky when we were launching it, and it really didn't. It was such a burning problem for us and the people around us. And so we set out to go raise about $300,000. We ended up talking to hundreds of people, got hundreds of no's, but luckily about 40 people said yes to us. So very, very small investments, really investing in this mission of building a healthier food system.
You, of course, began the business with no real experience in the food industry. So what were some of your earliest challenges and how did you persevere?
One of the best things about doing what we did when we did it is that we knew nothing. And so the naivete of not knowing what we were getting into allowed us to kind of take the leap and do it. I think if we knew what we knew today, we probably wouldn't take that leap. Our first restaurant was a 500 square foot old burger shack right off campus, really iconic looking white and green little tavern. That space was way too small to actually build a restaurant. You know, we had to build an ADA bathroom that was bigger than our kitchen. We had to build storage in the parking garage above the street and cart food up and down every single day. 2 days before we were gonna launch and have our big opening party, someone had come in, stolen the computer, and it had everything on there, all our operating manuals, all our recipes, literally everything. We stayed up for 2 days rebuilding everything from scratch, and while it was really painful, I actually think some of the recipes came out better. You got so our biggest early challenge was learning how to lead people. We had a really good sense for the brand and the community and the strategy and the idea, but we'd never been a boss. As the company evolves and it scales, it's still one of the things that we have to continue to adapt to. It taught us from a very early stage about problem solving and how we could turn these little crises into opportunities, and it's a mantra that has stuck with us.
So many restaurants fail, especially within the first year. So looking back, what would you say was your recipe for success?
From the very beginning, Sweetgreen was not about a product. It was about a greater ethos, a mission, and really a why behind our brand. Our mission is our guiding light. It's solving this huge, huge problem of the food system today. And we really think we're at the very early stages, whether it's how we source our food and our commitment to the quality of our food and how we treat our farmers. It's how we make our food from scratch. It's how we design our restaurants, how we give back to our communities. It's all of those little things that I think sets us apart. We're riding two massive waves and secular shifts in the way people consume food. One is people want to finally eat healthier food, have kind of woken up to the fact that they want to know where their food comes from and what's in it, and they're making the connection between what they eat and how they feel. We believe that food is healthcare and can be medicine, and so that's one massive shift. And the second is around technology and how technology impacts people's lives. Most prominently, it's helped us get closer to our customers. Today, over 50% of our orders are done through our mobile app, far more than 1 million customers. And what that does is it just makes it easier to eat healthy food. We're working to digitize our supply chain, really to create end-to-end transparency from where our food comes from, the conditions in which it was grown, and being able to show that to consumers. In our world, it's a lot about reducing friction. When you talk to a lot of consumers and you put yourself in their shoes, people always want to eat healthier. What gets in their way is some sort of friction. For us, we try to think about this desire and friction matrix. How do we make the healthy food more delicious and desirable, but also reduce the friction in which you can access it? Once you have that direct connection to your customer through technology, as well as this emotional connection to the brand, there's a really powerful opportunity to make a positive impact in the world.
Continuously taking risks is something that keeps any company fast moving and innovative. As a leader, how do you encourage a culture of failure?
We love to create a safe space for failure. And in a weird way, it gets harder to do the bigger you get. And so a lot of it has to do with how you set up goals and structures. For us, it's our OKRs around taking some big bets. We have this one thing called the Learning Forward document, where when we do fail, we almost celebrate it. And it's not to celebrate the failure, it's to celebrate the learnings from those failures. And we also believe that gratitude unlocks the fullness of life, and that doing it personally for yourself and also sharing that with others just brings more awareness and joy to the world. We do have a practice here where once a month we write gratitude cards, both to our internal customers and our external customers. So we get together and we write handwritten notes to our team members who are giving great experiences to guests, as well as guests who've written in notes of gratitude to us. And so it's our way of creating this virtual cycle of love.
For all the conscious creators out there, what are three things that aspiring mission-based entrepreneurs need to thrive?
My advice for mission-based entrepreneurs is, one, get as close as you can to your customers. Really get to know them and not just answer their problems that they say they have, but know them enough so you can anticipate what solutions you may have to make their lives better. Two, have a big mission, but start really small and focused. One thing that we did from the very beginning that I look back was one of the smartest things we did is we stayed very tight and focused, both in terms of our product as well as our geographic reach. Our first 15 restaurants were in Washington, D.C., and we had offers to go across the country, go international, I mean, to be everywhere and to serve everything. The number of times people asked us to do smoothies and sandwiches and all kinds of things, as well as to go everywhere. But it was really important for us to be the best in the world at what we were gonna do, which was serving delicious, healthy bowls and salads. And that gave us the opportunity to do so much more. Number three is that culture really does eat strategy for breakfast. Strategy will shift and your product will change, but having a culture that can withstand the ups and the downs is so powerful. Staying true to your values will really help you run the marathon. Entrepreneurship and building a business is really not a sprint. Resilience is so important. There are so many ups and downs. From the outside, it always looks like this beautiful story of started here and then here they are now. But on the inside, any entrepreneur knows that every single day you're on the verge of world domination and bankruptcy at the same time. And know that you just have to make it to see another day. I'm most proud of the culture that we built at Sweetgreen, this amazing group of people and brilliant minds that are so committed and work so hard every day to bring our mission to life. And I'm also really proud of my partnership with my two co-founders, the fact that we still have the relationship we do as friends and partners and leaders of this company. It's an amazing thing to be able to live that sweet life together.
The sweet life, not just for some, but for everyone. When we can live and lead abundantly, we create harvests that support us all. So maybe mom was right. What's good for us really is good for the world. Real foods to fuel the day and a brighter tomorrow.